What is a situation where common sense will actually make things worse? If someone has something impales in them, do not take it out. You could cause so much more damage and possibly cause them to bleed out faster. Put pressure around the edges of the item and hold the person still while waiting for emergency services. In the same vein as above, if there is a bad accident, do not move an injured person unless absolutely necessary, e.g. imminent danger due to fire, nearby moving cars, etc. Moving a badly injured person can cause further injuries. If there is no fire or smoke, leaving a person a car wreck is the best thing to do until emergency services arrive. A lot of movies show people dragging injured bodies away. And if that was real life and the victim had spinal injuries, that person is likely now disabled for life. An argument against an idiot. You cannot reason a person out of a position they did not reason into. Throwing water on a grease fire. On a similar note, putting ice-cold water on an oil burn. Quantum theory. When an airplane starts stalling and drops in altitude, anyone who's inexperienced will instinctively pull the nose up, which will make you stall even more and probably enter a flat spin. The correct course of action is somewhat counterintuitive, and it's to push the nose down to gain airspeed. As an older teen, I did flight lessons. Got as far as stall training and getting caught in an updraft on the same day before I realized I wasn't quite ready for it. Oh man, common sense makes my job so much harder. It seems like everyone thinks that you need to scrub your whole body down with soap and a loofah every day for some reason, and then put Neosporin on all their cuts. Most problems I see are self-caused. I'm a dermatologist. Predicting what other drivers on the road will do next. Safe driving is about expecting the unexpected. I try to explain this to my husband at the time. You have to be prepared at any second that someone is going to do the stupidest thing imaginable at any moment. God, I hate driving. The stock market money printer go burr spy puts a grease fire on the stove. Common sense says that fire plus water equals no fire. But that's not quite the case. Grease plus fire plus water equals second degree burns on my arms and some very disappointed parents. Burn the rest of the house down so the fire has nowhere else to spread. Anything involving exponentials. I tried and failed to explain the concept of exponential growth to a coworker for nearly 3 hours. The guy's a total weeb and latched onto me once he found out I speak Japanese. He started telling me about his katana that had the steel folded over 250,000 times. Yeah, he's really one of those. I told him it didn't. That it may have 250,000 layers. Doubtful. But there's no way it had been actually folded that many times. And that to get 250,000 layers, you only need to fold the steel about 17 times. You know, first fold you get 2 layers. Then 4, 8, 16, 32, if you double every time. He couldn't get it, literally could not wrap his head around it. There was no possible way you can get to 250,000 by doubling less than 20 times. Even when I literally counted it out for him, he just looked at me blankly for a few moments. Then shook his head and said, "No, that can't be right." Also, what's funny is that weebs think folded steel is a good thing, but folded steel is low-quality steel. They folded their blades to increase the strength and remove impurities because the steel available in feudal Japan was extremely impure. European swords did not need to be folded because they had access to better steel, not because they were inferior swordsmiths. Fucking thank you. Give me a short sword made like the late Vikings did over a shitty fucking katana any day. Oof. Most people are so off the mark when it comes to swords. Or any antiquated arms and armor. This idea that a katana would cut through a European longsword. It won't. Or that a knight in full plate couldn't get off his back. Or onto a horse without assistance. They could, due to their armor weighing so much. It didn't. Is ridiculous. One of my coworkers was mind-boggled at how William Wallace could wield a sword as heavy as 40 to 70 pounds. I doubted this right off the bat. Knowing a typical longsword might be 3 pounds with a larger sword such as a Zweihander weighing in at around 8 to 15 pounds. I looked it up, and while Wallace's sword was heavy to be sure, it of course wasn't near what he thought it was. Didn't have the heart to tell him though. Common sense implies general knowledge or reliance on gut feeling. Human brains are horrible at gauging odds over time. Yeah, we can do the math on paper, but in the moment we suck. So, that being said, anything that isn't a fight or flight response will quite possibly lead you astray. Moving someone in a major car accident. It's tempting to help a passenger out of the car and away from the scene. Unless there's a clear reason to do so, you should leave them in the car and wait for first responders. If there's a spinal injury, e.g. a fracture, moving them without AAC spine collar, a stiff collar that holds the neck straight, can result in a spinal cord injury, e.g. quadriplegia for life. Writing an essay. Don't write your introduction first. Write it last so it says exactly what is in the essay. Chances are, the paper you're writing will evolve slightly so it's easier to do the intro in retrospect. Or, write an introduction that helps guide what you want to write about. Your plan. Articulating your frame of analysis. Then be sure to come back and rewrite it. Your point stands though. The actual introduction should be written after everything else. Shopping. Marketing takes advantage of predictable consumer behavior and manipulates you all the time. Consumer common sense just makes you more vulnerable to manipulation. 1. X is more expensive than Y, so X must be better quality. 2. If X is $100 and Y is $200, Y is expensive, but if X is $100, Y is $200, and Z is $400, Z is expensive and Y is moderately priced, etc. 1. X is more expensive than Y, so X must be better quality. When it comes to buying presents for somebody else, especially kids, people will say the lower priced item is just as good as the expensive item. I'm confident of this even though I know almost nothing about the items I'm going to buy. The lower expensive item is the gift. Sometimes the lower expensive item is a decent substitute for the more expensive item. Sometimes the lower expensive item is missing key functions that make the item not worth the cost. Savings. Apparently in investing in stocks, for the past 27 years, I've followed the market closely and my boss has talked to me a lot about that. He learned to bet against me, and has made tens of millions. For example, if any company makes a great product like Sun or Red Hat, he short sold them since I recommended them as your I keep seeing Microsoft produce insecure garbage that they never fix. So he bought Microsoft stock on margin and made enough to buy a new house on Lake Washington. Basically, if a company makes too good of a product, then they're investing too much in the product versus marketing. Companies selling sizzle rather than steak are the ones that seem to always be successful. It's depressing to know that you can make money by always betting against yourself. It's not about the product. It's about the asterisk earnings asterisk. You're thinking, wow, this company has a great product. It's sure to be successful and think it would be good to buy shares in that company. Which is fine. There's nothing wrong with buying shares in a company that you like. But your boss knows that there are a lot of people thinking exactly like you and investing in the same stock. Then the company releases its quarterly financials and investors see that the stock price is way higher than it should be. So they sell, and the price tanks, because the investors who make money on the stock market aren't looking for which company has a great product. They are looking for which company can make a lot of money selling its product. From what I have heard, sometimes being in the military, no, it's a vast majority of the time. Moving to try get out of quicksand. Online arguments. A well-structured argument based on facts will actually hurt your cause. All you need to do to win an argument online is refuse everything the other person says and call them racist, and you'll win. Edit. I don't do this, but I usually get called xenophobic or racist for disagreeing with people. It won't even be about politics. Could be about sunflowers or astrophysics. It always happens. This isn't true. You're just being racist. Hey, you're right. Basic military training. Working for the government. Voting. In the UK at least. If you lean left, your best bet is not to vote for your preferred party, but to vote for the party left of the Conservatives, Lib Dems, Labour, SNP, Greens, Plaid Cymru, etc. That has the best chance of winning the constituency. It means sacrificing some ideals, but overall it's the best method to get less Conservatives, the majority party, into Parliament. Asterisk rise in American asterisk. If you hit oil, ice don't accelerate or brake. Most people panic and brake, which makes thing 10x worse. In an automatic, don't brake or accelerate. Just steer into the skid and wait for force to run out. In the manual, try to force down gears to slow down and steer into the skid. I live somewhere that snows, and the first snowstorm I will go to an empty parking lot to slide, spin, and drift. Drifting is mostly for fun. I would rather make mistakes there than on a crowded road. Also, when it snows, I will be attentive to what the other cars are doing. Paying attention has saved me from a couple of rear-endings at stoplights. If for whatever reason you found yourself stranded in the desert and you had some water with you, common sense might lead you to believe you should ration out the water to try and make it last longer. This is the exact opposite of what you should do. Whenever you're thirsty, drink until you're at least quenched. Being thirsty is the first sign of dehydration, and you will need to be hydrated for the best odds of survival. Keeping hydrated will help your body cool off, and if you get too dehydrated, you will become weaker and eventually delirious, which is the last thing you want. I've heard of people being found dead in the desert with plenty of water still on them as you're trying to swim back to shore if you're caught in a riptide. You absolutely won't make any progress, and you'll just exhaust yourself. Swim parallel to the shore for a while, until you're out of the current, and then back to shore. Removing a motorcyclist's helmet after a crash. Please don't do this. You could likely paralyze them if they have a neck injury. They will often try to remove their helmet or ask you to because they are dazed and full of adrenaline. Don't touch it, and try not to let them remove it either. Unless there is something life-threatening, of course. The way people respond to first aid for eye injuries is often surprising. Many people try to remove the foreign body in the eye or rub their eye due to itchiness pain, which you shouldn't do. Maybe this doesn't relate to common sense as much, but alkali injuries, toilet cleaners, oven cleaners, are far, far worse than acid-related injuries in the eye. Often acid quickly denatures proteins in the eye, forming a boundary and inadvertently stopping the spread. Alkali injuries are often less painful, but more likely to cause permanent damage, e.g. blindness. People present to the ED much slower for alkali injuries because they are less painful. Acid-related injuries sound more serious, but alkali is far worse. Dealing with an irrational person. Common sense says, explain yourself politely. It will open a pleasant discourse. Nope, doesn't work. It's like playing chess with a pigeon. They're going to shit all over the board and not care what moves you're making. Putting hot water on a frostbite to warm up. What do you do instead of why? Somebody feel free to correct me if I'm wrong, but I think you gently warm it up, i.e. exhaling warm air onto the frostbitten spot and holding it close to your body. Holding it in the relative area of a fire but not very close. Or slowly putting them in warm water. I forget the reason why you gently warm it. Unfortunately, it's probably about the universal rules of living organisms. Gradual change is safer than an abrupt one. Dumping water on a grease fire sounds good in theory, but all you get is an insurance check. When you're trying to navigate office politics, leave common sense at the door. It's all illogical from here. Friends, thank you so much for watching and have a good day.